natural pleasure being out here. I mean, look at it. We've got the beach and the dunes and the sky and bald eagles flying around. I've seen as many as 36 eagles in one trip.
Russ Lewis visits this stretch of the Long Beach Peninsula almost every day. But Russ is no ordinary beachcomber.
I kind of look at myself as a custodian of the beach. What I usually do is just drive along, picking up all the litter that I can find along the way, like right here. There's a plastic bottle. Sometimes you might find 50 or 60 in one day. This is a chunk of styrofoam, and it's put together with these little pellets. The birds will peck away on it, and you find dead birds on the beach occasionally. And they actually starve to death because their craw is full of plastics. You know, these big objects that you're seeing, it all breaks down into small stuff. It's in the sand, it's along the beach zone, and it's breaking down one molecule at a time. The ocean is full of plastic. We just can't get around that.
Since 2012, Russ has been collecting about 6 tons of garbage off this stretch of beach every year. But one man's trash is another man's data.
Smells like old times.
Yes, it does.
Dr. John Chapman of the Hatfield Marine Science Center is one of the researchers taking a deep dive, if you will, into the science of marine debris.
Oh, yeah. Look, here, this has an oyster on it. You wouldn't see this on something from this coast. Mm-hmm. We discovered what Russ was doing here quite late, actually. And he'd been accumulating this debris in this very, very particular way. He gets everything that's there, he bags it up, he writes down how many bags he got, where he got them. And so we have this constant record of how much debris is there. Ugh.
John's specialty is invasive species.
Yeah.
So he's very interested in the life forms that are hitching a ride on that debris.
Oh, look at that. This barnacle is still intact.
Yeah.
But it wasn't until June 2012 that John even realized that trash from overseas might be a source of biological invasion.
The dock was from the Misawa fishing port, and it was deeply coated by Asian species. We were shocked to discover that species could drift across the ocean on floating debris. We thought that that was impossible. And not only were they surviving on there, but they were going through generations on these objects.
The dock was a remnant of the massive earthquake and tsunami that struck northern Japan in March 2011. The tragedy claimed some 15,000 lives, wiped out more than $200 billion worth of infrastructure, and in one fell swoop, changed the study of marine invasion ecology forever.
It's this enormous door that opened for us to see something that we had never imagined was possible and that it was huge.
To date, researchers have found roughly 350 marine species, most of which have never been documented on our shores before, all carried across the ocean on man-made debris like plastic.
These are plastic rafts, right? These are artificial rafts. A tree or a branch would disintegrate and fall apart before a significant amount of it could cross the ocean. But now, the plastic and the fiberglass and the concrete and the steel objects that we make, they don't disappear. They carry these things across.
Amazingly, 5 fish were found living inside the boat. They'd hitched a ride. One of the big fish is now living in an aquarium.
2 barred knife jaws and 21 yellowtail jacks that also rafted over from Japan on tsunami debris now make their home at the Oregon Coast Aquarium.
The significance of finding these animals is twofold. One, it is very fascinating. Temperatures and salinities are very similar in this situation. and the animals are doing quite well, thriving and growing and feeding and swimming in their school. At the same time, we are always concerned with animals that would not normally be found here.
This part right here,
the Pacific Northwest's environmental similarity to many foreign waters makes it possible for Russ Lewis to find creatures that have survived the long trip across the Pacific Ocean, even 7 years after the tsunami.
Here comes a batch of bags of marine specimens.
What this means is that debris is scattered so far that we're still seeing it 7 years later. It was like breaking the deck on the pool table. The balls went everywhere.
Oops. And the dates are on there, yeah. They're all labeled.
Oh yeah, that looks like... And now we're seeing that the balls really did have incredibly different histories.
Back at the Hatfield Marine Science Center, John and his colleague Dr. Jessica Miller are piecing together those histories, in this case, of mussels.
It's 59.4 millimeters long, and it's...
So one of the most common species that we found on Japanese tsunami marine debris is the Mediterranean mussel, Mytilus galloprovincialis. So this mussel has arrived on over half of the 600 items we've looked at. This mussel is native to the Mediterranean, but it has invaded Japan and other parts of the world. And over 90% of the mussels that arrived in Washington and Oregon were capable of reproduction. They had eggs and sperm.
Chemical analysis of the mussel's shells helps Jessica understand how long each animal was adrift and what environments it passed through on its way across the ocean.
Learning as much as you can about those rafts and who's arriving on them and where are they arriving, at least help us to evaluate the likelihood of some of them becoming established.
While researchers all over the world puzzle out the long-term impacts of this rafting phenomenon, one thing is clear.
I think it's another example of how humans are impacting global processes.
The Japanese government estimates that the 2011 tsunami swept about 5 million tons of debris into the Pacific Ocean. That massive influx also gave John Chapman a surprising glimpse into a much larger problem.
Our assumption was that the tsunami debris would cause a giant uptick in the accumulation of debris on the coast. What we found instead was, relative to how much other stuff there was, that it didn't make any difference in all the rest of it there. We couldn't detect it. So the thing that we're grasping with now is, holy cow, it's mind-boggling how much debris is out there. We don't know what this is going to do, which is the worst thing of all, perhaps. We don't know. We just know that every place is connected with every other single place on the planet, and it's called plastic trash.